start myself off. So my name is Kathleen O'Connell. I'm the local history librarian for the city of Carmel by the Sea. This is our an oral history interview for the Centennial Oral History Project. I'm here with members of the Carmel High School class of
1951.
Thank you very much. So to start off, I'm going to ask three of you to say your full name and where, when you were born, and when your families came to Carmel.
Okay.
So, if you would please start.
My name is Wesley Theodore Brandhorst, commonly known as Ted, because my father was Wes, so I became Ted. My widowed mother and myself and two very young children came to Carmel in, I think, 1947 from Seaside, Oregon, where she had run into some difficulties and needed to come to Our Lady of Carmel to save us. She was a strong Catholic, and she would look at the map and find a place to go where her religion would save her. So anyway, we ended up coming to Carmel in 47. And I think we came in the same day that the Johanna Dolman and her two sons, Hans and Franz, came in. And so they were our very first acquaintances in Carmel. We were both at the same rooming house, which was a way station, before so that you could figure out where you were going to go in Carmel. So we settled, and our first location in Carmel was a very small house, very, very small house, directly across from the fire station. Kind of an interesting place to live, because whenever there was a fire engine leaving at night, the doors would come up, the lights would go on, and right through the front of this little hutch and wake us up. But it was what we could afford at the time. The first academic experience was down at the mission school, eighth grade. I went into the eighth grade down there, and Mr. Fortier was one of my companions down there, and Ronald Stoney was another one, and I think Barbara Horn was a third. Those are the only three, I think, that were in that class down there. The nuns taught us, and it was I had been in Catholic schools before with both nuns and brothers, so I was accustomed to that. And, I managed to survive John and Ron Stoney down there in that class. And we all made it out to Carmel High School, the class of 51, the next year. I found that it was very fortunate that my mother had chosen Carmel for us to light in. I had brothers, George and John. I won't go into their histories, but turned out to be a wonderful place to grow up in. And I have very, very fond memories of Carmel. I had one or two paper routes most of the time I was here as a kid to make money, and that sent me around the town a lot, getting to know people, getting to know streets. I can remember at one time in filling in on a route, I delivered papers to Robinson Jeffers' house, the Tor house, and sneaked into the bushes to watch the great man walking around his garden, no doubt composing poetry at the time. But I was fond of his poetry, just as I was fond of many of the writers who lived here, like Jack London and people like that. I would read them assiduously. Memories of the beach volleyball down at the bottom of 13th Street during the summer times, and exploring the beach areas and walking around the Point Lobos and exploring Point Lobos and going further down the coast on a little small motorcycle I had to explore beaches down that way and get to know Big Sur a bit. And so it was we had a wonderful time at Carmel, small town, 5,000 people. We had a class of 69 people. You could get to know everybody in the class. I mean, so much better than in a class of 300, most of which you would never have any contact with. But I think we all got to know each other to some extent in that class. And one other little point: my mom, who was in disguise when we came down here, in effect, introduced us as Brand. Her name was Marguerite Brand, and I became Ted Brand in high school. And I don't think any of the other students knew that my last name was Brandhorst until graduation day, when they announced the next diploma to hand out was Ted Brandhorst. And everybody looked around, who's Ted Brandhorst? And we know Ted Brand, but we don't know Ted Brandhorst. That was a moment of levity there. Anyway, that's my first thing to talk about, the wonderful teachers, the fellow students. Benny and I became very fast friends with the Dolman brothers, and we kind of hung out together, and I spent lots of time with them and their mother, Johanna. We used to get up every morning and, you know, go down to the beach at 5 a.m. and walk the Carmel beach almost religiously. She loved it. And she wanted to do that up to the day she died.
What was the house that you delivered the papers to?
You mean my little house?
No. You said you delivered papers to someone?
I delivered papers to a number of houses, of course, yeah.
Hey, it was Tor House.
Yeah.
Oh, his house. The Jeffers house was Tor House, yes. Yeah. I was filling in that day on that particular route because most of my routes were up here near where I lived, you know, so the guy would bring the papers to me and I would do the local area.
But how many customers did you have for your paper?
How many customers? God, I don't remember the number, but I'm sure you must have had, you know, like 75 or 80 or 90 customers, something like that, you know, because you had to collect money from them, you know, collection time. Yeah.
And did you have to ride bicycles?
I rode a bicycle, and you threw the paper very accurately onto the front porch, you know, so as to avoid the rain. A little hard to do in Carmel, yeah. But that was the.
I'm not a native Carmelite. I was born in Pacific Grove, and when I was 7, I think we moved to Carmel.
What year?
That would have made it about 7 years old or so. Oh, around 1941. Yeah, I equated with the start of the war. We listened to the war being declared in Pacific Grove, and then the next thing I remember, I was in Carmel. Not as a result of the war, anyway. I went to Catholic school. I started in Catholic school in Monterey because it was the only Catholic school around. And then after we moved to Carmel, I used to take the bus from Monterey to Carmel. And that's where I developed my people-watching skills because I could always manage to miss the bus I was supposed to catch from Monterey to Carmel. So I had, I don't know, 40 minutes or 20 minutes to sit in the bus station. And I would look forward to that. After we moved over here, there was no Catholic school. And I stayed and commuted. But then Mrs. Stoney, a classmate of mine, Ron Stoney, Dr. Stoney, his mom was very big on getting a Catholic school over here, and so was my mom. And so they agitated and fussed, and they got the Carmelite nuns down the coast a little bit to donate or give access to their sort of vacation rooms below the monastery. They had 4 or 5 rooms there where nuns could come for rest and relaxation. They let us use that, so I think I left Catholic school in Monterey in maybe the 4th grade, went to 5th and 6th at the monastery school, which was temporary, make-do, but fun.
Could I ask you a question?
Sure enough.
Was that before the school program at the mission had begun? And that's why I see. Okay.
Yeah. They didn't have, but they were building there.
Yeah.
And after the, I think it was the 5th and 6th at the, down the coast, the 7th grade room was ready, so we moved into that, and while we were in that, they were building the 8th grade room, so we sort of went, as the school grew, we moved up.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha.
And then after the 8th grade, we went to the high school course. And Ted and I were talking about it, trying to remember other people in the Catholic 8th grade, and the only person that we could remember, well, Ron Stoney, of course, and Barbara Horn.
Her last name now is Tiernan, Barbara Horn Tiernan. She's married to Frank Tiernan, is that it?
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway.
But I got one of the nicest compliments I ever got in my life from her. She, at a dinner 5 years ago or 10 years ago, she said, I always remember your staying after school with me until my mom got home, and we'd shoot baskets. And they lived up the valley. And sometimes the mother wouldn't get there to pick her up until 10, 15, 20 minutes late. And the fact that she remembered that impressed me so much. And I was flattered by that. And she was my first dance, I think. The school put on a dance with all the boys and all the girls. And I really believe she was the first young lady I asked to dance. And that
She's
set the bar pretty
pretty
high.
I have to tell a Barbara Horn story, but I remember kind of fascinating on Barbara Horn is, boy, you know, my heartthrob girl in the class. But I was too socially inept at the time to do anything about it. But I used to admire her from afar. So I remember one time inviting her, my mother, I said, oh, there's this girl, Barbara Horn, in the class. Oh, you know, she's so pretty. And to my horror, my mother went to the Horn family and got a picture, this big a picture of Barbara from Barbara Horn's mother and brought it back to me. Yeah. And I thought, oh my God, there's no way Barbara wouldn't know about this. I'm so ashamed. You know, that my mother would have to go and speak for me to get a picture of Barbara Horn.
I'll have to drop out of school.
And so I immediately put this in the strong box somewhere, you know, and until we had a reunion of a couple of years ago, we were up at Diane and Bruce's house in the little garden area, and Barbara was sitting there, and we got to talking, and I confessed to Barbara how much I had admired her and not done anything about it in high school, and I talked about the picture, you know, and we had a good laugh about it, you know, and she confided in me. She said, Ted, I know you like me. Yeah, I could tell.
I think the Catholic non-Catholic thing is interesting. It wasn't a problem, but I mean, not to meet the kids that were in your high school graduating class until your freshman year. It's sort of funny because the people from Sunset, they were together, knew each other, hang out and stuff from the grades on up to the eighth grade, and
yeah, there were only a couple few people who came up from the mission to that class, and the bulk of them had come up from Sunset. Yeah.
Yeah, you, Ron, Sony, Barbara.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
myself.
Just a handful. Yeah. Just, you know.
Like moving to a new neighborhood.
But we integrated well with the group. Yeah. You know, we were, after we got into CHS, we weren't regarded as the mission group or anything like that. No.
It was a small enough town where we knew everybody anyway.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right across the street from me was Lee Loganar.
Yeah.
Lee and Bobby Loganar. And on the corner was Deborah Gearing and her brother.
You know that house that I described that I in the beginning of the ranking, there had gas stations on both sides of it at one time. Now they're gone now, but there were gas stations on this side and gas stations on... We were surrounded by gas stations, yeah.
You know, you didn't call it a service station. You don't have service stations anymore.
Service?
Yeah.
Service? What's that?
Pump through your windshield, start the gas,
no,
through your windshield, check the oil.
Check. No.
Not that tire looks a little...
You got to do everything yourself.
Yep. Yeah.
Including putting air in your
tires. Air and water, you have to put a coin.
No, that's gone away. All that's gone away.
They were service stations.
Before we get too much further along, so if you could just introduce yourself and then say how you're connected to Carmel besides this one.
My name is Michele Fortier, and I was born in France, in Paris. My parents were artists, and we happened to be living there then, but when World War II looked like it was going to start, they decided to come here. And I spent time here as a child. I wasn't a native Carmelite, and I grew up in Southern California, but my parents had friends in Carmel, the Crowley family. They were the old grandfather was the painter and was part of the original group of artists that settled here. And they had the property, Ted Crowley, my peer's father, grew up in the Carmel Highlands where they had a lot of property. So we'd come in the summer and play at the beach. And another friend, it was just interesting, my father had a friend who was a sculptress, Muriel Pulitzer, and her grandfather was Joseph Pulitzer, and her mother owned a very elegant little shop on Ocean Avenue. And then, you know, we stopped coming. My mother became an invalid and couldn't travel, and so I just finished growing up in Southern California, and met John actually at a party in Laurel Canyon.
Down south. Okay, so you didn't meet him in Carmel, you met him
down
south.
I lived in San Francisco for a while, and I had a lot of friends in Berkeley. And they would talk about this wild friend they had. I heard about John, but I had no idea who he was. You know, absolutely no idea. And I never met him, but I had a lot of mutual acquaintances. And we had, John had a friend, and she was not a close friend of mine, but a friend named Barbara Scherer, who's a life coach, and she's on PBS a lot and so on. And John was going to be in Southern California, and he called her, and she said she was going to a party that night. Why didn't he meet her? And I was at the party. And I don't know, John, it was in the days when women were wearing hip hugger pants that were a little low and a little short top, and this strange man walked up to me and put his finger in my navel and said, "Great looking navel." That was my introduction.
That sounds like John.
Yeah. And a year or so later,
now it's been immortalized forever.
Yes.
Oh, boy.
The children would be so thrilled. And so a couple of years later, we were married. I rediscovered him, and we moved to Northern California, from Las Gatas. Stayed with his dad in Carmel for a while, raised 5 children. And really, when we were first married, we went on a trip to San Francisco and looked up some of these mutual friends, and one of them said, when John was away from the dinner table, "You didn't marry him. Tell me you didn't marry him." It will never last. Maybe 6 months. So after 58 years, I should really write to her. She lives in France now, and I could say, "You were wrong."
He's changed. He's mellowed.
Oh, much.
Oh, yeah.
Actually, I don't believe you said your full name at any point.
Oh, John Fortier. Yeah. Well, if you had all the Catholic, it had John Joseph William Fortier. Yeah. And I left the church for most purposes when I was about 12 or 13, somewhere in there.
Oh, really?
Yeah. But until, were you an altar boy?
No, I'd never been an altar boy. I managed to escape just before,
confirmation?
Confirmation. Yeah. Yeah, just before confirmation.
Confirmation? I got a pocket knife from my uncle.
But I think if I'd gotten confirmed, they would have made me an altar boy. Yeah. I escaped.
I and Ron, too, were altar boys before that.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
But I gave all that up. But a wedding, serving mass at a wedding was, you know, that was big bucks.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Well, yeah.
You mean you could make money in the Catholic?
Oh, they'd always give a tip to the servers. But the money wasn't enough to stay in the business.
I see.
There are other ways. I left from there and went to Monterey Peninsula College, and saw that college and I just had nothing to do with each other. I sat in the lounge and watched guys play chess, and hearts, and drink beer in brown paper bags. Supposed to fool anybody. But
they played chess up at UC Berkeley in the student union too, so you would have found it there as well.
Yeah. And it's funny, when I couldn't get into Cal because my grades were atrocious. But when I left here, after I graduated, I went to work in my dad's store for money. And on weekends, I'd work on fishing boats in Monterey.
That was a drugstore, incidentally.
Oh, yeah, Fortier's drugstore.
Yeah.
And it's now, I don't know what, on the corner of Ocean and Dolores. It's funny, the bank now is a store. I remember. But everything's changed, of course. I started MPC, and that wasn't good. It was too loosey-goosey. And a lot of the vets were coming back from World War II, and it was not funny, but it was odd. They would take a class like surveying, and a lot of people took surveying but dropped out. They dropped out after they got the equipment, and the equipment was all paid on the GI Bill. The GI Bill used to be very different. It would pay everything, you know. And if you wanted to go to school in a taxi, they'd pay for it. I mean, it was ridiculous. It was a new idea. And they didn't have any controls over it. So a guy would sign up for the surveying, and they'd get maybe $200 worth of equipment, and they'd sell it for $50 and then party for a couple of days. And that was going on. I mean, they'd take a secretarial course until they got the little typewriter. They got a typewriter, and they'd sell that.
And you weren't getting anything.
I wasn't getting anything. But I took a typing class because I really wanted to learn how to type. I used to watch my dad type up prescriptions on a little typewriter, and I thought it was fascinating. He wasn't that handy with anything, but he could type his ass off, you know, these little teeny prescription things. And I was so impressed that I took typing. But one day I got my fingers...
From Lloyd Miller? Lloyd Miller?
Yeah, I guess it was.
Yeah, it was Lloyd Miller. Yeah, yeah, that's right. He was a teacher.
Anyway, I realized that it wasn't working, so I went in the service. And Howard Veit, another classmate, not a Catholic kid, but he and I ran around and had some adventures. And he went in the Navy, and I went in the Air Force. And that was an interesting career. And when I got out of that, after 3 years, 9 months, I started teaching.
Talk a little bit about John's teaching career, because I think he really hasn't covered some things that he should, because he developed as a person through teaching, and it was just remarkable seeing it, watching. And what his very first job, full-time job after we were married and he'd finished college, was teaching in Los Gatos at junior high school. And he started there as a substitute teacher, and they were so impressed they asked him to stay, so he stayed. And they gave him all of the problem classes, and he had to teach. He taught journalism and social science and math and English and it just everything. And he also started a boys' home ec program. They'd never had that, and it was great because I think, you know, these kids are just on the cusp of puberty or into it. And he could discuss all sorts of things with them that their parents perhaps didn't discuss or their friends discussed and gave them a lot of bad information. But he also taught them to sew. He taught them to repair sewing machines, which in those days broke down a lot. So he'd go to the girls' class with the boys and they'd fix the sewing machines. And he had the girls, well, girls in my day, when they were in home ec, they made aprons and potholders and things. His boys made bikini bathing suits for their girlfriends, house dresses for their mothers. It was just amazing. And then he decided he'd have a survival class for them, you know, a unit in where they could, you know, learn to trap an animal if they were lost out in the woods.
I have a feeling, John, like you could relate to people in, you know, that you were teaching in a special way, because you had problems coming. I mean, you were a bad boy in a way coming up, and you could relate to people who had all kinds of
absolutely.
As you were saying that, I was saying being on the edge was not uncomfortable.
You could understand the kids that you were helping. That was the way I, in our various reunions, that's always the way I kind of saw you. John's helping the kind of person that he was.
Absolutely. These boys that had problems with their fathers or didn't have them, I'd go out and pick up the newspaper on Saturday morning and they'd be sitting on the curb saying, "Is Mr. F up yet?"
Mr. F.
And they called us Morticia and whoever, they, because that show that my Charles Adams family, I had long hair.
I see.
So they loved that. But at this one, I have to do the survival class, because what John did was tell them to build traps.
What's your time?
Animal traps. They were going to have mice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So John brought in all of these mice, and everybody had a trap. And they were down on the floor trying to lure the mice into their trap. And the door opened, and Don Eddy, the superintendent of schools, came in with two women and hats and gloves from the Board of Education in the state of California, and they'd come to see the class. Everyone's on the floor, and the mice are running around.
I wasn't too picky about language. As long as it didn't get really crude, they could.
Yes, and so they were saying, "Damn it, kick up my truck." So Don was a cool man, and he introduced them, and they all said goodbye, and John came home and told me about it, and we thought, well, where will he be teaching now, and will he be teaching now? They loved it. These women loved it. They thought it was just great. So that was one of his teaching stories. I won't go into all the others, but they were all great, great. And he had young adults, and he had Afro-American students, and he had Native American students, and the big bonus for our family was he'd bring them home. He'd have young adults and older adults, and so our children just had this really rich background of people that they, you know.
Well, now we're going to come over here.
Okay, This is post-high school stuff, and I'll try and make it compact. I wish I had some exciting bad boy stuff to tell you, but it's mostly good boy stuff.
One more information is sufficient.
I got Dorothy Wright, the deputy principal of Carmel High School, gave me, I think, a $100 scholarship when I graduated, and I applied to two universities, got accepted at Stanford, got accepted at Cal, couldn't afford Stanford, decided to go to Cal, and I was thinking, oh, I'll be lost in those 50,000 students or something like that, but it turned out to be a wonderful experience. I went to Cal, mainly surviving on scholarships and busing dishes for the food part of it, and I was going to become a high school teacher. So I majored in English, which I'd been good at in high school, and minored in math, which I'd also been good at in high school. Well, I quickly hit my peak at after calculus. I figured, well, I thought I was a good mathematician, but differential equations is a lot different than advanced algebra. So I decided to focus more on the humanities than on mathematics. I also visited one too many blackboard jungles in the San Francisco area when we were out visiting high schools, and I eventually came to the idea that I didn't really want to be a high school teacher. But what the hell was I going to do? And I was spending a lot of time thinking that over. When I graduated, I decided that this was the one chance to get to Europe. So I worked in Sacramento building roads for the Bureau of Public Roads for several months, saved every penny, and went to Europe, and I was going to stay in Europe for as long as the money lasted. And I hitchhiked over there and stayed in youth hostels. And when you do that at 50 cents a night, you can make money last an awful long time. So I spent many months in Europe. I think it was, you know, like 7 or 8 months or something like that. And when I came back, I worked in New York driving a truck for a little while, and then ended up driving a sports car for a company to get back to California. I delivered the car in Bakersfield and got back in. And at some point when I got back to California, a friend said, Ted, you always loved library work. Why don't you go into the library and information science field? You can get your degree, you can get your MLS in a year and a half, and you can then get a job at the library, which you love, and then you can figure out what you really want to do in life. Well, it provided an answer to something that I hadn't been able to come up with for myself. So I entered the School of Library and Information Science and did well there. And at the end of it, the dean recommended me for entering the intern program at the Library of Congress.
What year did you finish your degree?
Well, that would have been, 57 or something like that.
And yeah. This was at Cal?
At Cal, yeah. I had my AB in English, and then I got my MLS in Library and Information Science. I remember him calling me in, and he said, you know, I'm prepared to recommend you for this wonderful program at the Library of Congress, Ted, but nobody from this school is ever going to be recommended who has a beard. And I had a beard at the time, you know, we both had beard. So I said, Dean, give me 24 hours and I'm your man. So I went out, took pictures, cut the beard off, and went to the Library of Congress. And it was a wonderful program because it allowed the special interns to work 2 or 3 months in every section of the library. So you ended up being one of the few people who knew the whole library instead of just focusing on one area, rare books, you know, microfilm or whatever it might have been. I could have stayed there probably my whole life, but I thought, my God, one job, a whole life in one job. I mean, I loved the place, but I didn't want to be in one place my whole life. So after a couple of years, I had an opportunity to get out into the information industry, which was just kind of a fledgling industry at that time, just beginning to spring up because computers were just coming in. And I went to a small company of about 60 people called Documentation Incorporated, and enjoyed that. And then there came a time when the company decided to bet the company on going for a NASA contract, and everybody in the company stopped, and for 3 months we worked on writing a proposal to run what was called the NASA Scientific and Technical Information Facility. And believe it or not, the competitor we were fighting against was North American Rockwell. Okay, it was a 60-person company. We won that contract, unbelievably won that contract. And we had to bring out the first issue of the Abstract Journal within 3 months after winning it. I think I personally did every item in the Abstract Journal for that first issue. And we rose through the ranks and became an assistant director at the NASA Scientific and Technical Information Facility. And we did that for 10 years. And then at the end of 10 years, we lost the contract for financial reasons. So I had a chance to stay on with the new company, but I thought, well, 10 years, I've done this for 10 years. I think maybe I'm ready for a change. So I went back, I stayed with the company I was with. Turned out to, once I found out how where the company stood, it looked like it was a mistake because the company was not doing well. But I found an item in the Federal Register about ERIC, the Educational Resources Information Center. And again, a big company had that contract, but I ended up writing the proposal across a three-month period, and we won that contract. So I became the head of the ERIC Processing and Reference Facility in Washington, running. The job of that facility was to collect all the literature dealing with the field of education written in the English language. Collect it, put it into a database, and provide anybody who wanted copies with copies, paper copies. And I did that for 30 years. And I retired from that job. I retired in around 2000. Yeah. Both of these jobs of running the NASA facility and running the ERIC facility were very much to my taste. I loved them. I loved it because it was collecting literature and making it available to other people. And that suits me fine. I love to do that. John, let me ask you a question. I've always thought that because you and Ron Stoney were kind of close down at the mission school, that you had a really friendly relationship. And I always wondered whether you and Ron kept in touch with each other over the years. Is that true?
I've always felt close to Ron. I don't know why.
Yeah.
Of course, we go back, you know, like to the third grade or something in Monterey.
Yeah. I didn't realize that before.
And their mothers were great.
Yeah,
and our moms were both bridge players and
okay.
and both good Catholics and stuff. And it's funny. I think of Ron as a brother by another mother. You know, to use that old expression.
Well, that's interesting. I kind of felt the Dolman brothers were my brothers.
Yeah. Oh, Ron killed me because he's being a cardiovascular surgeon. You know, he's smarter than the average bear, but he's also he designed and built a sorting pen for cattle because he has a ranch and they run some cattle, and he designed this thing, and part of it is metal posts in the ground, but the rest of it is wire cable from the elevator in University of San Francisco medical building or something. He saw this one day when he was leaving, and he said, "Well, where's that going?" "Oh, that's going to the dump." "Oh, no." And he saw it right away as being something useful, and he applied it and used it in this sorting pen. And always does a lot of work himself. He told me something the other day. I got to get this in the record. When he lived up the valley, someone said at the gathering yesterday that it was sort of cold and foggy and damp in town sometimes. And they didn't want to live in that. So he found a place up the valley. The way he found it was he kept track of the weather and everything, and he got a place just beyond the fog line. Just beyond the fog line. He noticed and made it a point to find out how far up the fog went.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't want a house in the fog thing, built it just outside it. So he didn't have to travel extra far. He traveled far enough to get out of the fog, and there's their house. Yeah. And it's so cool.
Going back, may I say something? Yeah.
Please, I was just about to bring you guys back to Carmel.
Okay, well, I wanted to come back to Carmel because, you know, I remember when we were in Carmel, there were actually two movie theaters in Carmel. There was the regular movie house down there at the bottom of Ocean Avenue, and then the Golden Dove Playhouse, you know, more down towards. And there were two movie theaters, and I went to them as frequently as I could. I suppose you did too, right? Yeah, it was wonderful. Now there's no theater. And yeah. You have to go to Monterey in order to see a movie.
And they had puppet shows, too. I remember the puppet shows.
Yeah. Where were the puppet shows
at? Mercedes, where we're going to be having dinner, I guess.
Anyway, I wanted to mention the movie theaters. They're gone. And they were big in our time. And the other thing I wanted to mention was the Ralph Chandler Harrison Memorial Library, the main branch. There was a lady there who was a librarian. I think her name might have been Niles. I'm not sure. I'd have to check. But I established kind of a special relationship with her because she would advise me on things that I needed to read or should read and so on. And also, they had a collection where they protected it from the off-shelf collection, a Delta collection, if you will, because I was still reading books like The Doom of Dogma and The Triumph of Truth, things like that. I remember that was one book that was in this Delta collection because if it had been on the shelf, an ardent person, an ardent Catholic would have probably taken it out and burned it, kind of thing. So she would give me some of the books that were in the Delta collection. But she was a perfect librarian. I guess it's one of the reasons I kind of always took to library work, because she was very smart. She knew everything that was in the library. She was willing to help a student, and she was willing to get me books out of the Delta collection. And I all credit to her.
Is that a code word for restricted books?
Yeah, well, it often is in a library. They have a special name for it, the X collection, the Delta collection, or something like that, yeah. And things that have to be protected, because if they were on the shelf, they would disappear because of people having a special interest.
Do you remember the first time you went to the Harrison Library?
The first time? Mm-hmm. Well, it would probably be the first year that I was here, because I was a library hound, and that was sometime in late 47 or something like that, I think. Yeah. But that was a great library, and I think it served the community very, very well.
Yeah. I did want to ask, there was mention that your house was or became the Rinky Dink restaurant.
Yeah.
Can you tell me about that a little
bit? All right, real quickly on that. This is a very small house. There were really only like two rooms and then maybe a kind of a back porch that served as a kitchen or something like that. But it became the Rinky Dink, I was told. I wasn't here at that time. And then when the Rinky Dink quit, it was, people said, Ted, you know what happened to the Rinky Dink? And I said, no. And they said, well, they put it up on a truck and they took it out to the middle school. And so when I came to a reunion, I went down there to check it out. And there it was. There was my house in the back of the football field, full of football-related equipment. And I thought, what a strange, thing to have happen. As a matter of fact, during this reunion, I went down to see it at the same location because I was going to measure it, because people would never believe it was as small as it was. And I was going to measure it so I'd have, and it was gone. It had been torn down and it was gone. So it's no longer there.
And you lived there with your mother and two brothers?
Two brothers. We had double bunks just inside the door, and the kids were there, and I was in bed on the other side of the room, and then the next, our mother was in back, and then the kitchen just beyond, but very small, just a very small room. Most of the time we were out of it, but the idea of it becoming the Rinky Dink restaurant, that gives me a kick somehow. Anyway, so it existed for a while. It's it was still useful down in the middle school, and now it's aged to decrepitude and it's gone.
Sort of like us. We're on the same path. Might catch up with our damn thing sooner,
But you guys are still here, and that's pretty good. I was going to ask, so let me see if I've gotten this straight. You both were at the mission school at some point and all this at the same time?
Eighth grade.
And I've heard that you were a bit of a wild boy. So what were you all doing exactly in eighth grade that...
You mean you want him to admit to some of the wild things he did? I'm not going to squeal on him, okay?
What are some of the things you allegedly did?
this was... My dad had a drugstore, and in the old days you used to be able to buy a bottle and put a CO2 cartridge in it and trigger it so all that force went into the bottle. And you had carbonated water for the price of a little thing. Those things fascinated me. I mean, anything explosive or flammable, I'm there for it. We lived in a strange house. It was a three-story house, and the third story was a turret. Now you see these all the time in sort of sleazy pretend castles. But this was an old one, two-door, and I used to go up in the tower with the metal tube for my mother's vacuum cleaner and a bunch of these CO2 cartridges. And there was a little trigger that you pulled and it would break the seal on the back of it. And that thing, if it weren't restrained or guided, would go nuts. It would just fly for miles. So I would hold that at the end of the vacuum cleaner tube and launch it. And it would fly from 4th and Randall Way, which is where the house was, toward Ocean Avenue. I never heard of a car being hit by one of those, or a person, or a dog, or a cat. But man, I must have launched 100 of those things out.
I'm glad you never pointed it at me, John.
Yeah.
And then he built rockets with our sons.
But, you know, was Ron Stoney doing this kind of thing, too?
Well, Ron was a lot more responsible.
But the two of you were inseparable down there.
Yeah,
we went around together down there.
Yeah. I think that's when I did good things.
When you were with Ron?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, you know, go do a little shooting or a little swimming. I was with Ron's family when I got polio down in Big Sur.
You got polio?
Yeah.
I'll be dead.
Coincidence, Michelle got it too. And yet we're both, you know, mobile and so on and so forth. My only thing was my ankles and knees got weakened. I wasn't good. Still not. But, we were down in Big Sur together, and we were in the water, you know, from dark till dark. And when I got it, the ambulance came down and picked me up and took me up to Carmel.
I have to say, I kind of always thought you and Ron were the same kind of person. You were both, you know, bad boys or something like that. But Ron got off and became a respected surgeon. And so
it's hard to say something about Ron. First of all, he's as ballsy as anybody. I mean, he will do, if he wants to do something, he'll do it.
Yeah.
And
didn't stop him from being there, you know, getting becoming a doctor.
No, not at all. Yeah. As a matter of fact, when he was a kid, they lived up beyond the fog line. And I used to sleep over up there on weekends and stuff. And I remember his mother was a really nice lady, Catholic. That didn't manifest itself in our relationship, but she was just nice, and she always told me that you can have all the milk you want after you eat, but you won't drink while you're eating. Yeah. It was a funny thing. But he used to kill and dress and sell chickens to people, chicken, you know, cleaned out, ready to cook, up the valley.
Ron did?
Yeah.
That's where he learned surgery. Okay,
well, there you go. But that impressed me because, you know, it wasn't a matter of being destitute. It just was an intelligent thing to do. They could raise chickens, and they had a nice little thing. Right now, his sister lives up there. What's her last name? What's her name? Anyway.
Yeah.
No, he was there for it if something happened.
But didn't your uncle sort of mentor him too? John's uncle, Bill Coughlin.
Mentored him.
Yeah, Uncle Bill, Dr. Coughlin.
Was a doctor, and
was your uncle, did he live around here?
Yeah, he was my mother's brother. He lived next door to us. After a while, but he lived a couple of blocks away from us.
Have we touched on the things you wanted us to touch on?
To and fro some. There are some things that I heard when you guys were talking earlier, something about making adobe bricks.
That was down at the mission, right?
Yeah,
because that's where adobe bricks were made. Much of the place is constructed out of adobe bricks. Yeah.
And many of those bricks were my bricks.
Explain the context
okay,
of that.
There was a guy named Harry Downey.
Okay.
And he was an architect and
mission
an
restorer. He restored
mission restorer. Yeah, you can find him if you look up Harry Downey. And
he's buried down there. He's buried at the mission.
Well, that's only right.
In the little courtyard on the side. He's buried there. Yeah.
And I don't know if he bought cigars that were this long and used, but he always had one in his mouth.
Yeah.
I never saw him with a long cigar, but he always had a cigar. And he'd work here like a rented mule. when Ron would get sent out for, you know, some bad judgment, or
bad judgment.
Or I would.
He'd send us out nice to Downey, buddy there, right?
and working for Harry Downey was like, you know, he would work it. So we made adobe bricks, and adobe bricks, you know, they have the clay, and horse manure was a big or cattle commoner was a part of it, and you'd walk on this stuff when it was wet. If it was whatever you wanted done, you did. And Ted remembers the bell tower, going up in that was an adventure.
You really weren't supposed to, but we did anyway.
And did you sing in the choir?
I don't remember singing in the choir. I think maybe my voice had changed by then, and I was no longer that fine tenor voice that I used to be.
Ron, again, sang in the choir. I sang in the choir. And on more than one occasion, we sang with Bing Crosby, because Crosby was a big Catholic, and we lived out in Pebble, had a house out in Pebble Beach. And he'd come into the mission to services.
Hey, I don't know whether you knew that, but at the house in Pebble Beach, it was off maybe the 13th hole, and if you sliced off the 13th hole, you'd end up in Bing Crosby's backyard.
Oh, yeah.
And the thing I remember about that is he was the only homeowner along there that had an electrified fence. And I thought, Bing Crosby's such a nice guy in the movies, but he's the only owner with an electrified fence where we had to risk getting electrified in order to retrieve our golf ball beyond the wires.
So now they're gone.
Well, it was that. The other thing I remember, and maybe you remember this, his kids would sometimes attend the basketball games up at Carmel High School. And I always loved Bing Crosby, you know, in the movies and so on. The kids were a little, you know, whats, you know? And nobody, I shouldn't say this for but anyway.
The poor things became adults like that.
And I don't think they had happy lives, the kids. But nobody really liked them. Nobody in the school liked those kids.
Yeah, they really threw their weight around. And, and I never knew anyone that liked them, and I didn't like them. That's for damn sure.
Boy, if you didn't like them, they were really bad.
I didn't like them because they were arrogant and, you know, and so forth.
Did all the boys go out and gather golf balls and resell them?
Oh, did we? I had a pile of...
So, from the beginning, what's the story?
About golf? What? Or what?
Retrieving golf balls. Making some pocket change.
Oh, yeah. You could sell them. Yeah, you'd go to Pebble Beach, and people would hit off the 9th and 10th and 11th fairways because it would roll down towards the beach, and you'd go in there, and you could come away with 25 balls easy on a day.
And sell them back for 50 cents or something.
And you could make some money that way. And that was done by, certainly done by me.
Yeah,
and
me too. Yeah. Now, what was the hole where the tee was up here and the
oh, yeah. That's like the seventh. The seventh. That's the seventh.
Because
that's the shortest hole on the course. Yeah.
Right after the green,
his water
dropped. and the surf was serious down there and everything. But if you had the audacity to go in, there'd be enough golf balls to fill this in one little crevice, and you just scoop in the rag as fast as you could.
The next hole was also rich for golf balls because remember there's a big cliff on the right, and if they tried to go over the cliff area to the eighth hole, I guess, lots of balls ended up down in there, and you could just go down there and have.
They're usually brand new top flight balls. I mean, you know, you didn't have many.
Pebble Beach golfers used expensive golf balls, and they were always in good shape. Yeah, you could count on it.
That's the story.
I had a pile at one point of balls found there that I carted around for years and years and years and years. And then I said, my God, I wonder how these balls. I went out, I put one down to hit it, and it just shattered. The ball was so old. It had gotten hard, and you hit it with a driver, and it just blew apart like... just fragmented. Goodness. So I didn't hang on to these balls anymore. I gave them,
something interesting I haven't heard brought up anywhere. Forest fires.
And down the coast.
And up the valley. Way up the valley. I guess it would be, I can't say. But my interest in the fire was the fact that I wanted to go fight them. You know, they asked for volunteers, and I guess it was at the high school. And when was it, junior or something? But anyway, there were a bunch of trucks, or some trucks out in the parking lot, hopped in, went out to the fire, worked on the fire for 4 or 5 hours, and then it was time to go. It wasn't a serious fire like some of we're hearing about. And then when it was time to come back, they had a bunch of trucks, a lot more trucks, because trucks had come from different places. And I went to a truck and hopped on, and some guy said, you don't want to be on this truck. And I said something like, excuse me. And he said, this isn't the truck you want. And I said, well, it's a truck I'm on or something. And he said, well, if you want to go back to, what's the local prison or...
Local prison?
Yeah, it was a truck.
Soledad.
Not that local, but I mean, over by Salinas or someplace, there's a
county
farm.
Couldn't tell you
the
name of that.
Yeah, there was some kind of county jail. And these prisoners had been offered the opportunity to get some fresh air and go fight a fire, and they had. And this was a truck full of prisoners who were on their way back to their lockup. And the guy was being...
He looked like a bad boy.
Something drew me to the truck. It was just that I think it was the nearest truck, and I hopped on. It was the wrong truck for me. On that
the things he did, I think, were always bad, but sometimes they were not thought out well.
And
I was going to mention the time that your father asked you to... He had a house that he kept, because during the Second World War it was very difficult to get pharmacists, so he provided a house and then it became a rental unit, and apparently he bought a new stove for it and asked John to dispose of the old stove.
Take it to the dump is better said.
I'd take it to the dump. Yeah. But those cliffs down towards Big Sur were a lot more interesting than a dump.
Oh, yeah.
So he and a friend, and I don't know if it was Ron or not, I don't want to say, decided it would be marvelous to see how far it would go if you pushed it off the top of the cliff.
Push what now? What are you pushing?
The stove. The stove that was supposed to
you
go to
You were throwing
dump.
A stove off of a Big Sur cliff?
Yes.
And littering the landscape with rusted metal?
Somewhere down there is a... little four burner gas.
Very bad boy.
Very bad boy.
Yeah.
It gets worse. The story gets worse. So
and then what happened?
He went home and his dad said, "Did you take the stove to the dump?" And he said, "Oh, sure. And he said, "Well, that's funny because the new stove isn't here anymore."
Holy.
What did you do with the new stove?
Oh, are you kidding me? Is that what happened?
That's what happened. He took the wrong stove,
talk about
and then
bad
he
judgment.
Took the and threw it off a cliff.
Jesus.
And that might be why you were not expelled from school, but you were sent to the Jesuits for a while.
Oh, you know, I've got to say, the reason I stayed at the school as long as I did, as much as I did, was because of Marquita Bray.
Marquita Derby Bray.
Yeah, Marquita... Bray was, she and my father grew up in the same neck of the woods up in Nevada City,
English
California.
Teacher.
Yeah, and a very take care of business lady. I mean, she was...
But at the same time, a huge lover of Shakespeare, and she tried to infuse us with that love of Shakespeare. I remember that so well. Yeah. Wouldn't you say that?
Oh, yeah. She was an inspiration for the students. And I don't know, I think she cut me a lot of slack because of Dad. I don't think she suffered fools gladly as a rule. But
no,
she
was pretty strict,
that's
true. Yeah.
And she could turn that on to me, too. And I admired her. I respected her. I did what she said.
Mm-hmm. That was not,
really?
That was probably why
that
you became a teacher.
It was a factor. It had to be a factor. Because she could handle stuff. And I've always been lucky in teaching... that something in me is simpatico with something in others.
She was eloquent, and she could be dramatic. And I think you listened to her, you know, and her words really seemed to count. Maybe more so than many of the teachers who could talk, but it was, you know, it was at the same kind of low level. Marikita could make emphasis, or whatever. You know, she could scare the hell out of you. Yeah, right.
That's funny. You bring up something that in my teaching, I've always tried to tell my students that there's a huge difference between hearing and listening. And most of you have gotten this far by hearing what's going on. Now you're going to have to start listening. You're going to have to start really understanding why something is being said. Not so much what's being said, but why is it being said? What makes it worth saying? And once you can get a student's attention thinking that way,
it's all one shady. Thing we might, that we, I don't think we've really done a lot of, but we might do here just with a few moments we have left, is mention some of the teachers and their names.
Yes, please. I was about to ask a little bit more about, and let me just start that, and you can add to it.
Okay. But I remember Mrs. Down, who taught mathematics, and I thought she was an excellent teacher of algebra, advanced algebra, solid geometry, and all those levels that are taught in high school. The only thing I ever held against her is when I went on and discovered that there was something called calculus up at Cal, I thought she should have warned me. She should have warned me about this, because we didn't even get the word mentioned to us, or the fact that I thought math was an endless array of advanced algebra, just getting higher and higher, and it isn't. But she was great. Mrs. Beaton, who taught French, and Enid Larson. Everybody loved Enid Larson, who taught biology. And I remember dissecting the frog.
Ron's name keeps coming up for me, I think. But Ron Stoney attributes to her his, and Uncle Bill, he gives the nod to Uncle Bill through Dr. Coughlin.
Yeah.
But Enid Larson inspired him.
And she inspired a lot of people. And she kept going with her interest in animal life and frogs and so on. And after she left teaching, I think. Mr. Westover.
Oh, yeah.
Him, and
that big guy.
Big guy. He sponsored the golf team. And he was the one who made deals with Del Monte Lodge in order to get us onto Pebble Beach for free.
Now, did he teach science? Is this Westover?
I think
he wore glasses like this.
That's right. He was a science teacher.
Walt Frey was one of the wild ones in the class ahead of us.
Yeah.
Walt was a wild man. And one time he screwed around with an experiment in a science class that Westover was teaching. And Westover had said something like, Mr. Westover,
chemistry, for example. Yeah. He taught chemistry.
There was an experiment going on, and he had told the students not to, just let it sit. And Walt went up and played with it, and I don't know if it caught fire or blew up or what, but Westover came in the room from the little back storage room at about that moment, and he picked Frey up and threw him through the door.
Walt?
Out. Walt Frey. I didn't think it could be done, but he threw him so hard it opened, crashed the door, and the doors are like, in a prison.
Westover was a big man, must have weighed 250 pounds or something like that.
And Walt was not a kid, he was all AAA football and all this stuff. And he was sitting on the sidewalk, or the walk outside this door while the door slammed shut. I did not see it, but I heard it from 10 people, and it was identical, the story of what I just told you.
Who taught shop? I can't think of his name.
Baldy?
Yes.
Yeah.
But you haven't
got
the name.
It was not his given name.
No, you haven't got the name, though. I can't think, come up with the name.
It was Rich's cousin's father or something.
That's right. Our son-in-law.
I used to get A's, most of the time in the classes, and you have to take a shop thing. So I settled on metal shop, and I took metal shop under Mr. Name is escaping us. And that's that was one of the B's that I finally got in metal shop. I couldn't create, mine was a little crooked. Not my specialty, yeah.
Well, I noticed none of you became mechanics or anything.
I can't resist this since you're open to it. In that place, I had about a 10-foot piece of like molding. I don't know why it was. Well, it was for the wood shop where the wall meets the floor, I was playing around with that thing, and I threw it like a spear, and it had a lot of wobble in it, and it hit a table and bounced up and honest to God speared the clock in the room.
Typical behavior in high school of this generation.
It was not premeditated. It just turned out to be
just curious.
What could be construed as a stupid thing to do. Well, it was a stupid thing to do, given, but I did not intend to do what had happened.
He taught metal shop, wood shop, and auto shop. And he taught all the shop you know, practical kinds of things, yeah. But his name just will not come.
I've forgotten that he was related to our son-in-law.
Was it Mr. Mitchell who was the principal?
Mitchell.
That sounds right. Yeah. And Dorothy Wright was sub.
Yeah. There was one teacher that taught English or something, and all the boys lusted after her. And she wore very...
You've got to come up with a name for me to believe this. Yeah. What is this?
She used to dress more like she was going to the Carmel Mission for a... I'll think of it.
Okay.
Yeah. She was very, very...
The only English teacher I remember is Mrs. Bray. That's the only one I ever had, I think. Yeah.
But, maybe it wasn't English.
But the teaching was good and exciting, and I thought... You know, I give all credit to the school and the relationship those teachers had with the students, really.
Now, you said 65 students in the class?
69 was the number that I came up with. And depending, you know, it's whether you count a student who came in and was there for 4 months and then left, that number will vary a little bit depending on that
count.
I mean,
the graduating class.
But the 69 for the graduating class, I believe. When Ted Brand suddenly became Ted Brandhorst.
I've got to say something about the whole thing. If I hadn't grown up here, I don't think I would have liked the product that I would have become.
Is that right? That's a fascinating statement.
The ocean and the geography and the people and the high school and the Catholic school didn't kill me. And what doesn't kill you makes you stronger, right?
Well, I agree with that.
I am grateful.
The high school gave me this, a certain love of learning. I don't know how much was innate, how much was, and Dorothy Wright was so kind and so, giving me that. I think it was called the Carnival Scholarship Check. I got a check for $100. My God, that set me on my way. When I went forth, it was like I had been. Go forth and conquer somehow, It was really great.
So just as a last little round, if you guys could each say what is either your favorite aspect of Carmel or the most important part of this town to you, having grown up here, having spent time in this place.
Well, I think the history of Carmel meant a lot to me, as I said earlier. I mean, when I learned that, George Sterling and Jack London had lived here and met here for abalone parties on the beach. That it really excited me. And when I learned that Robinson Jeffers was here and had settled here as the greatest meeting of land and sea in the world and so on, directed me to his poetry. So there's a number of authors that I've read as a result of being in Carmel. And it's such a charming place. It's a place that sticks in your mind if you journey someplace else in the world. It's very easy to make comparisons between what you had in Carmel and what you find elsewhere in the world. And it compares very favorably with things all around the world, in terms of what it offers to the eye and to the heart and so on. And then you had this marvelous then escape route down the coast to the mysterious Big Sur area. I used to go down and just explore beaches that were... you couldn't get to them because unless you had a motorcycle, because there was no place to park your car. So you could, but a motorcycle could get in there and go off the road. So you could explore beach after isolated beach after isolated beach all the way down. And I can remember Point Lobos. My God, what a beautiful place! If you've ever explored Point Lobos, I can remember going over there. I've walked all the way around on the coast, all the way to Point Lobos, just on the coastline, walking. And I can remember finding little caves and places in Point Lobos where I could sit and read poetry and write poetry and little places where there was nobody but you and the crashing waves and the beautiful stuff like that. It's an inspirational place. And I'm so pleased to have grown up here.
I know you didn't grow up here, but you did spend time here as a child. What does Carmel mean to you from that time?
Well, as a child and growing up in a family of artists, I wasn't terribly impressed by authors or painters because they were always sort of around.
Can you see the camera?
Yeah. Oh, yes.
I don't think she's on the camera when
well,
she's talking.
That's all right. They can still hear me.
You can hear your dulcet tones.
Yes. And so I think it was just the landscape, the woods, and the...
Don't worry about it.
Something about to go off, I'm out of here.
What have you got in your pocket, Joe?
Yeah, man.
Kaboom. Just the ocean and the seashells that I gathered up and the smell. I always remember the way it smelled. And we live at the beach now, and I think that's part of it. I didn't want to go back to Southern California and look. We'd live by the ocean, the sounds, the trees. I can remember gathering the moss and taking it home with me. I'd never seen anything like the Spanish moss. Just the whole atmosphere.
Yes, a very special place.
Yes, beautiful. Tor Rasmussen, who just died a co-student of theirs. His dad was Norwegian, and in his youth he'd been a seaman and a carpenter, I think, on board a ship, and he'd been everywhere in the world, and he told Tor that this was a place he wanted to stay because it was the most beautiful place in the world, and he'd been everywhere.
And to finish us off, your trip.
I think, it just came on me sort of in this last hour or so, having been born in Pacific Grove, going to school in Monterey for several years, and then moving over here, I think it gave me an awareness of and concern about prejudice. Because Carmel, I think, thought of Monterey and the inhabitants as a notch or two below Carmel. They were fishermen, stuff like that. And in Carmel, if a person didn't own a shop, a store, there was no industry. What did people do? I mean, we didn't have an automobile factory. We didn't produce anything. We just served the public's wishes as far as entertainment and so on. But having been to school in Monterey, I knew a lot of Monterey kids. And even when I was in high school, I still would run into them and sometimes look them up. And Tommy Archuleo, I don't know if...
Well, the difference between rich and poor.
Yeah.
Well, I was in Carmel, but I was aware of that from within Carmel because I was poor, and that limited the areas where I could go or the people I could associate with in Carmel, because there were so many wealthy people here, and there's so many artists and so on, people that I couldn't... I wasn't prepared at that point to, climb up to, so to speak.
I think that's what I'm most grateful for. But what I said earlier is true. I mean, I feel like I was really fortunate and enjoyed the experience of the people here, the environment, and the school, the ocean. When I get really stressed, I'd just go down and either go for a swim or sit on the beach for a couple of hours and get my head straight and come back to the world that was on my mind, making me nervous.
Good tactic.
And the library, If I spent as many hours in this library as I told my parents, I'd be a lot smarter than I am today. I'd have a couple of LLDs and PSQs and all that stuff. But the library was a nice starting point for the beach or Monterey or wherever there was. But I'm in debt of the library. I have a library card here still. Do I have to renew it?
Eventually, yes.
Oh yeah, I probably should while I'm here.